Classical saxophone recital. So I'm super, super excited to be here. I live in Ohio now. I'm born and raised in Colorado, so I'm very, very honored and thrilled to be back here performing on this stage once again. So I describe this recital as being like the weather in Colorado. If you don't like what you're hearing, wait 10 minutes and you'll hear something different. So I decided to program this recital in chronological order. So you heard first a piece by Bach, written for the cello. The second piece is also written for the cello. So this is Edvard Grieg's Sonata for Cello in A Minor, which I heard a cellist play and said, I could totally play that. So I stole it. So you will hear the world premiere of this transcription for the cello of the cello sonata for the saxophone, featuring the wonderful and talented Ms. Dominoki on the piano. So we put this together for the first time yesterday. First time the piano part had ever been played in its lifetime. So I hope you guys enjoy Grieg's Cello Sonata in A Minor. Thank you. so much. So we're going to trade out our pianists here. Saxophone piano accompaniments are known for being just fiendishly difficult. So I want to especially recognize both Kim Joyce and Bobby, who you just saw, for really doing a tremendous job on some very, very difficult music. So give them, the two of them, a hand. Gives me a chance to drink some water in this very, very dry state. So the next piece that we're going to play, we're going to go from a world premiere to a piece that's been played literally thousands of times in the saxophone repertoire. So this is the Concertino de Camera by Jacques Ibert, which is a true staple in the saxophone repertoire. Just about every classical saxophone player plays this piece at some point. So I performed this piece about 2 years ago at my first master's recital at CCM. I decided to put a little bit of my own flair on it. So there's a long cadenza in the second movement, which I decided to completely rewrite. I rewrote it using the B theme from the first movement, which I think is a very beautiful melody that gets underutilized during the course of the piece. So it's two movements, which is actually three movements. The second and third movement will be squished right up next to each other. So I hope you guys enjoy Concertino de Camera.
Thank you. Thank you.
So this first piece you'll hear is for soprano saxophone. This isn't a big clarinet, it's a soprano saxophone. And this is a piece called Chapter 1, Page 1, which is based on the book Tropic of Cancer by Henry Miller, which is a very interesting book. It was banned when it initially came out for having too many adult themes and adult language. But in the 1960s, the Supreme Court ruled that because of freedom of speech, that this book should be allowed to be published and sold. So this work has kind of become a champion of freedom of speech in literature. This piece uses a lot of interesting effects, namely delay. So essentially that takes every note that I play and plays it again just about a second later. That's like this. So you'll hear throughout this, that again, every note I play happens about a quarter note later.
there, so I'm going to do the old slap in the face on my computer here. It's been on for a while. It's crappy. Apologies. It's going to happen one more time. Oh, it won't happen one more time. This gives me a great opportunity to recognize Dan Butcher, our wonderful sound guy back there. Everyone give Dan a round of applause. So I'll talk just a little bit about the piece some more while we get this all figured out here. I'm going to begin this piece by reading chapter 1, page 1 and 2 of Tropic of Cancer. And you'll hear throughout the piece some looping effects that I will create an accompaniment for myself, and I will both speak and as well as sing some of the text from the book. So I hope that you guys enjoy that. That's everything set up. Did anything? Well, then our sound check is all from not. It says it's being output. Thank you for being so patient, everyone. This happens from time to time. If anyone has ever worked with computers very extensively, you know that computers have good days and they have bad days. So we just need to convince my little MacBook to have a good day here. Well, while we're waiting for it, I'll go ahead and read you the text of chapter 1, page 1. I am living at the Villa Borghese. There is not a crumb of dirt anywhere, nor a chair misplaced. We are all alone here, and we are dead. Last night, Boris discovered that he was lousy. I had to shave his armpits, and even then, the itching did not stop. How can one get lousy in a beautiful place like this? But no matter. We might have never known each other so intimately, Boris and I, had it not been for the lice. Boris had just given me a summary of his views. He is a weather prophet. The weather will continue bad, he says. There will be more calamities, more death, more despair. Not the slightest indication of a change anywhere. The cancer of time is eating us away. Our heroes have killed themselves, or are killing themselves. The hero, then, is not time, but timelessness. We must get in step, in a lockstep, towards the prison of death. There is no escape. The weather will not change. It is now the fall of my second year in Paris. I was sent here for a reason I have not yet been able to fathom. I have no money, no resources, no hopes. I am the happiest man alive. A year ago, 6 months ago, I thought that I was an artist. I no longer think about it. I am. Everything that was literature has fallen from me. There are no more books to be written, thank God. This, then, this is not a book. This is libel, slander, defamation of character. This is not a book in the ordinary sense of the word. No, this is a prolonged insult, a gob of spit in the face of art, a kick in the pants to God, man, destiny, time, love, beauty. I am going to sing for you. A little off key, perhaps, but I will sing. I will sing while you croak. I will dance over your dirty corpse. To sing, you must first open your mouth. You must have a pair of lungs and a little knowledge of music. It is not necessary to have an accordion or a guitar. The essential thing is to want to sing. This, then, is a song. I am singing. While my computer wakes up here, I'd like to read one other thing, which is Henry Miller's author's note that he wrote about the book. The book is semi-autobiographical, so it's a loose story of the author's life while living in Paris. You getting anything now?
Still have no signal.
I did not turn on my master when I went up. Still nothing at all? So this is Henry Miller's author's note. One can live in Paris, I've discovered, on just grief and anguish. A bitter nourishment, perhaps the best there is for certain people. At any rate, I had not yet come to the end of my rope. I was only flirting with disaster. I understood then why it is that Paris attracts the tortured, the hallucinated, the great maniacs of love. I understood why it is that here, at the very hub of the wheel, one can embrace the most fantastic, the most impossible theories without finding them in the least strange. It is here that one reads again the books of his youth, and the enigmas take on new meanings, one for every white hair. One walks the streets knowing that he is mad, possessed, because it is only too obvious that these cold, indifferent faces are the visages of one's keepers. Here all boundaries fade away, and the world reveals itself for the mad slaughterhouse that it is. The treadmill stretches away to infinitude. The hatches are closed down tight. Logic runs rampant with bloody cleaver flashing. Been able to fathom. Happiest.
thank you again so much for coming out. It really means a lot to see so many. I see some familiar faces out there and some unfamiliar faces too, which is awesome. So I was thinking as I was setting up for this recital that it is such a joy to be finished with school and finally be able to just play for music's sake. So I'm not playing for a grade and I'm not playing for a competition. I'm just playing, making music to make music. And I hope you guys are enjoying the process as well. So I'd like to take a moment to thank Professor Peter Sommer for bringing me out. Yeah, a round of applause for Peter. If he looks particularly well rested, it's because he's on sabbatical right now. I'd also like to thank Carrie Kerr, wherever she is, for arranging everything, doing all the PR and everything. And one more time for Dan Butcher for dealing with all this madness. So one more round of applause for them. Anyone else that I forgot to thank? Thank you. So this last number is a piece of music entitled Grand Larceny. So as the title would imply, it's about a bank robbery. And I'll leave it up to you to decide whether they get away in the end. So this piece was written by a composition professor at the University of Southern California, who, in addition to being a wonderful classical music composer, also plays in a speed metal band, which consists of other classical musicians and other music professors from California. So if that gives you kind of an idea what kind of piece this is going to be, there will be a lot of electronic effects, and I will start the piece with some free improvisation using some of the electronic effects. So hope you guys enjoy Grand Larceny, and thank you so much for coming out.
Thank you. Thank you.